He's the fastest dancer on earth. He can tap 28 beats per second. His show has grossed over $100 million in the last 6 months. So I decided to come here. Look at this place, Dallas, Texas, along with 17,000 others, to meet the Lord of the Dance, Michael Flatley.
We feel bad we're interrupting you.
No, I got some candy, got some champagne there.
We've got candy.
I can't have the champagne till after, but you can.
How are you feeling?
I feel like a tiger.
I think ever since the start of the whole Riverdance thing, he was like a god. And I never thought I'd actually get the opportunity or the chance to ever see myself come close to him on stage. And now I'm actually dancing with him.
Girls, yes? Excited about Michael?
You betcha.
He's fantastic.
He is fantastic, isn't he?
He's awesome.
It's a one in a kind of a lifetime thing.
They're so excited as well for tonight.
Great. We're going to have a great night tonight. Texas is wild.
If you do well, the response is electric. You know, you play to the audience each night to see if you can better the applause you got from the previous night, and you say, right, we'll see what I can do tonight.
Just straight up to the centre. That's all. That's it. You go to a point.
Oh my God, if it doesn't go well tonight, you realise that's my fault. Because that's not fantastic.
And if it does, you realise...
That's an arrow.
It's great.
Yeah?
It's deadly.
Ready, Connor? Ready?
Yeah. All right.
In about 2 minutes, 17,000 people. Tonight, at the end of the show, you'll see a standing ovation. Guaranteed, guys. A standing
ovation. Guaranteed.
17,000 people up on their feet tonight. Watch.
Real important to me that people understand the type of energy that comes from it, because it's all about energy. Our whole show is about energy. It's real good, honest energy that comes out every night at 100 miles an hour.
Now, talk to me about these costumes, because I
like
them.
John Sheward in London made these costumes for me. Theirs are all Celtic designs. All of my costumes have unicorns on the back, because unicorn is the symbol of unity and peace and strength and power. See, they're all the same, but they're beautifully...
They're so beautiful.
...done and designed. Would you... Here, why don't you try one on for me? Look at this one here.
Should I try one on?
Come on.
This is my favourite, I have to say.
This is a beauty,
I'm trying on.
This is my favourite, too. It's a bit cold now, because it's been probably a little wet from me dancing. Let's see, let me get
Okay. How do we feel about that?
Wow, deadly. Isn't that great?
Deadly. I like the word deadly.
I got a new dance partner.
Tell us about the Eurovision, even if you don't want to, because that was just like turning point. Was that one of the best nights of your life?
Oh, absolutely. The Eurovision was magic. There was just something in the air that night. But I was very, very confident. I mean, I was hired to do a job. I was dead set to prove myself. I dreamed about this big line of dancers all my life. I dreamed about having a full orchestra.
From when? How old were you?
Oh, God, I suppose... when I was about 21, I was dancing with the chieftains. Even in the very beginning, I never felt comfortable dancing with my arms at my sides. And everywhere I went, people sort of expected to see me with holding my arms down. But I couldn't understand it, and I really didn't want to dance that way. When you're putting it together, if you time it right, that your music builds and builds, and you hold back, and you hold back, and you hold back, and at the end, when the dancers hit the line, the music goes, and everything flies at the same time. These are custom made. I actually designed this part myself. And then the taps come from upstate New York. Then the heels are made by another guy. These are aerospace designed.
Amazing.
And they're special high-tech aluminum that's on the front of some of those 747s or Concords.
Concord feet?
Yeah.
Because they fly?
Well, sometimes on a good night they're not half bad.
Michael, are you looking forward to playing in Britain?
Yeah, absolutely. We got some great dates there. I think Manchester and
Birmingham
and London.
Wembley.
Wembley. Wembley's going to be...
And you're going to break a record, right?
Oh, well, we certainly are going to break a lot of records there, but one of them is the most nights ever that anybody's ever played at Wembley Arena. And it's a big night for me, I have to say, a big time, because... You know, when I came out of Ireland, when the show first started, we went into the Coliseum in London. And I have to say that the people were really nice and really perceptive and warm and brought us in with open arms. I'll always remember that hospitality, and I'll try and return the favor.
On Central, Michael Flatley is the Lord of the Dance.
Michael Flatley. Lord of the Dance. A South Bank Show special. It's not usual to have Irish dance at the Oscar ceremony. It's not usual for any form of dance to get mass media coverage. But Irish dancer and choreographer Michael Flatley has changed all that. World champion amateur dancer, then support dancer to the Chieftains, then performer in and principal choreographer of River Dance, from which he parted most controversially, he is currently creator of the spectacular Lord of the Dance, which is touring the world. We followed him in America. A colleague talks about the way he builds up for every performance.
I love to watch from the side of the stage where there's just this big curtain in between him and, in New York, 8,000 people or 7,000 people. And he starts, and he has a whole routine. He walks around the stage 10 times or 15 times, and then he starts to jog around the stage, and then he does this amazing run. He's like a foal, like a horse, and he does these high kicks, and he's going round and he's getting faster, and there's this kind of tantric discipline to what he's doing, where he's this gladiator, you know. There's a big challenge to what he's going to give when the curtain goes back, and you see that when he comes on stage. There's this explosion. And you know that it's an explosion of a result of this elastic band that's been wound up for the last half an hour.
First thing I have to do is put my head and my hands and my feet into a big tray of ice to bring my body temperature down again. Because everything starts swelling. You can feel pulse all the way through your body, all the way to your fingers and your toes. You go past the point every night. You go past the point you should go every night. And I know it. And the dancers know it. I mean, doing an encore is more than we should have to do, but doing two and three encores, that takes its toll physically, emotionally, mentally. That audience is sucking the energy out of you. They're just sucking it out of you every night, and they demand more. They want to see you go past that limit. They want to see the 14th and 15th round. They don't want it to get over at 12. You know, that's when they feel like it's heating up. And so that's what they waited all night to see, and that's what you have to give them.
Listen very carefully to the words of that song, The Kerry Dances. Oh, the days of the Kerry Dances, oh, the night of the piper tune. Oh, for one of those hours of gladness gone, alas, like our youth too soon. But I think it's back, the days of gladness are back. And he may be responsible for it. He's liberated the Irish dancing.
I think it's a wonderful showcase for Michael and his talents. But I would sort of, I've described it once or twice as Irish dancing meets Michael Jackson.
He's two or three moves ahead, I think. So the best of luck to him. I'm delighted for success.
The whole stage presentation, to the lighting, to the costume, to the sound system through which the whole thing is replayed is, you know, it has more in common with a big rock event than anything else.
It was like I knew him all my life. He's the nicest person I've ever met, and he was so helpful and helped me through the part.
He deserves it. He's been waiting at the bus stop for a long time.
Well, let's start at the beginning. What sort of family were you born into and brought up in?
My mother and father came to the States in 1947. You know, we were just hard-working people. You know, we didn't have much money. In fact, our family didn't have any money, to tell you the truth.
Did your parents, they'd come from Sligo, hadn't they? Did they miss Ireland very much? Did they talk to you about it a lot?
Well, my father was from Sligo, my mother was from Carlow. They did miss it. I mean, sure, it's hard. I mean, particularly where we were living in Chicago, it was just a big melting pot of different kinds of people. And it's a tough city, you know, it's a tough city.
How many were there in your family?
It's five. I have one older sister, Annie. I was the second eldest, then my brother Patrick.
It's my big brother Ben. It's my little brother Ben.
Then Liza.
My sister Liza. Get some pictures of this girl, the prettiest girl in the whole room. This is the girl. Look at this, my sister.
And then Thomasina.
And did your father find work immediately when he came out?
From what I understand, he served his time at nearly all the trades. Plastering, bricklaying, plumbing, you name it, he did it. He was just a big, strong Irishman, you know. He was about 6 foot one and about 220 pounds and was all muscles. You know, it was just that way. My mother, on the other hand, was a petite redhead. And
that's where you get it from, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't know. She's, I don't think I got her full temper. That's probably a good thing. I went to a Catholic school, Little Flower, when I was a child, and then I even went to a Christian Brothers high school. It was tough being Irish going to my school, you know. It wasn't easy because there was a lot of different nationalities. I think I was probably one of the only Irish guys going there.
You mentioned tough, you used that word a few times. Is that one of the reasons why you took up boxing?
Yes, it certainly would be one of the reasons. You know, I used to have to go to school and I walked there every day. It was supposed to be about a mile. And I used to have to cross paths with the gangs of kids that were going to the public school. I got in my share of fights. It got to the point then my father just said, look, you know, let's go take some boxing classes and learn how to defend yourself. And everything became a lot easier.
Flatley pursued the boxing seriously, even as far as the Golden Gloves amateur title. This, with the basketball and the heavy construction work he did to make money, all built him to the peak physical fitness needed for the dance.
Did your mother take you off to Irish dancing lessons when you were young? Did it start in that sort of determined way?
Yeah, well, I was about, I would have been about 11 years old when she took me to dance classes first. And, you know, we were down playing baseball, my brother and I, and she sent my sister down and said, come on, you got to go. And we went home and I had no idea what was going on. They took us to dance classes. And the first night, I don't really remember it all that well, but I remember thinking to myself, I don't know. I don't know about this.
Your father says it's never too early to learn the songs and dances of your ancestors. What's ancestors? Never mind, you're going to dance. I wonder how I can die for Ireland if I have to sing and dance for Ireland too. I wonder why they never say, you can eat sweets and stay home from school and go swimming for Ireland. Mam says, don't get smart or I'll warm your ear.
You start at 11, dance class in Chicago. Presumably you're still at school, you're boxing, you're doing all the other things that young men do. You're thinking about what, you must be thinking about what to do to earn a living. Mm. And then did you go to Dublin deliberately at the age of about 15 to learn more about dance?
I went there to compete in the World Dance Championships.
Irish dance was all about competition. And while that at the surface sounds like it might not be a good thing, it actually was a good thing in that it taught you discipline and taught you drive and determination. And, you know, people that were winning were the people that tried the hardest and worked the hardest.
A big round of applause on stage, our world champion. Let's hear it for number 14, Shane Ryan.
I went to New York and I won. And they didn't know who I was or where I came from, and they didn't even hear it. They never even heard of Chicago, let alone me. You know, so a lot of the people there just, they had never seen my style, because already I was, you know, teaching myself and creating a new sort of style. And but boy, it became really popular, and I was so different.
You stand straight up and down and keep your arms against yourself and kick your legs up and around and never smile. My Uncle Pat Keating said, Irish dancers look like they have steel rods up their arses.
I was different in the way that I had never seen the way it was done. So what I was doing was creating the way that I thought it should be done, which means it was more than slightly more flamboyant than what they were used to seeing.
Can you give us one or two examples of that strictness?
The posture. It has to be so straight and so strict. Your arms have to be a certain way. Some people prefer you have your hands to the front. Some people prefer to the side.
This way, it can be this way.
But it has to be very, very rigid and very strict. You know, you've got to keep your knees together when you do certain movements. You got to cross your feet when you do certain movements. You've got to keep your kicks to a certain level. There can only be so many kicks in each particular step. For me, it was so hard to swallow. Dance the way I felt, and what they wanted to do was make me dance their way, and I had to do that to win the title.
What was it like going to Ireland for that first championship competition?
Terrible. It was terrible.
Did you go on your own, or did Pat Mother come with you?
First time I went on my own. There was a lot of Americans, but no one had ever won, and I didn't get anywhere close. I came back to Chicago and started working like crazy. And started working again, because I realized at this point that my teacher wasn't going to be able to get me there. I suppose that was the pivotal point when I became determined to teach myself. I didn't like losing. I wasn't used to that. So I came back and worked like hell, and then went back the next year, only to realize that there was a bigger obstacle. I was a Yank, and I came fourth. And, you know, everyone was putting the round around me, oh, you should have won it, you should have done this, you should have done that. But that didn't make it any easier, you know. Then there was only one thing left to do. I decided this wasn't going to be right, so I stayed out in Dublin, picked up a lot about how the Irish thought and how they did, how what they thought about dance, and how strict their rules were. So everything had to be altered accordingly. And then I went home, and I worked, I can honestly say, 6 to 8 hours a day for that year. I gave up everything. I did nothing except that.
and I won it.
Oh, what was that like?
It was brilliant. It was brilliant. And so then a lot of things transpired over the next few years. I came home. I left after high school. I opened a dance class when I was... I retired then. I was about 17 or 18. And I must have had 300 people there the first night. It just was huge. It was great. I was making loads of money, and everything was, you know, great that way. But I wasn't happy because I wanted to dance. And teaching, I don't know, you know, it's a strange thing, teaching, particularly in something like this, because it's not so much the kids that want to dance, it's their parents that want to dance, is really what it is.
Now one, up, come on, lift up.
Shane was practicing his reel today. Now this is a soft shoe dance. When I mean soft shoe, you don't have any noise coming from it. In heavy shoe dance, you have the trebles, you have the tips on the shoes, which give you the sound effect.
Back, hop, up, hop, hop. That's it. Good. Okay, watch your hands. Keep on toes. Keep your chest out. Keep smiling.
I began touring with different Irish groups out of Ireland and dancing. Gave up the school and went on tour with loads of different people, groups out of Philadelphia, groups out of New York City, groups out of Ireland. And then one day I got a call from the Chieftains.
When Michael joined up with the Chieftains, he was very much an amateur, but he had his sights set on where he was going, what he wanted to do. You know, he had this great idea that, you know, there was more to it than just getting out there with a whole bunch of dancers and delting away. You know, he wanted to put creativity into the dance with the music. He plays the flute, and he's a very accomplished flute player. So in the last tour, I used to have him do a little bit of a solo on the flute, which is completely new to him after 15 years. And why not? You know what I mean? He was just one of the boys. Times, you know, you had to say, listen, hang on here, Michael, you know, let's mould this into the band, you know. I can't build a planet for you there yet. But, I mean, he would have gone to the moon if necessary. You know, he was just that so, you know, creative in his own mind that it was very difficult to keep the brakes on.
I would test what it is I was doing against audiences all over the world with the Chieftains. And see what their reaction was. You know, there were nights you just get so pumped up and the audience is flying and the music was so brilliant. I would go out and one night, instead of doing a spin, I did a triple spin and the audience starts screaming. So what do you think is going to happen? I'm going to do that every night, naturally. I'm going to do five or six kicks in a row. Because why? I was always told, you can't do that. So I started doing them over my head, five, six in a row, and the audience started screaming. It had to be a certain way that had the drama and power and passion of Ireland, and no one had ever done it.
Jack.
And a bit of the unusual as well.
The unusual?
Aye, that Dubliner cheese from Kerrygold. A mature taste with a hint of sweetness.
Where did you come across our fine cheese, Jack?
In England.
In England?
Why, aye, it's everything it's cracked up to be.
Ah, the crack.
Aye, the cracking taste of Dubliner, a great cheese from Kerrygold.
When I grow up, I'm going to wear a football kit to work. I'll mainly be a footballist, but on Tuesdays I'll be a zookeeper and look after the stick insects. And on Thursdays I'll be a daddy. But I won't get married, because girls don't like football and they whisper.
Wherever they're going, give them a great start. Senatogen Startup, the refreshing fruit juice drink with our special blend of vitamins.
Now that you can save £500 on all escorts, you'll have some extra cash in your pocket. So, what will you do with yours?
British Gas proudly announces a new pipeline. Because next year, we will be supplying not only gas, but also electricity, which could bring savings on your electricity bill. And all the reassurance that comes with British Gas. British Gas, the home of energy.
Go ahead. Baked potato chips, fruity things, biscuits, fruit, chocolate and cheesecakes up to 97% fat-free. So go ahead with McVitie's.
New Blue Fairy for antibacterial protection and peace of mind. New Blue Fairy, as tough on germs as it is on grease.
With BT EasyReach, sending a message is as reliable as delivering it yourself. The battery lasts for weeks, and when you don't want it to beep, it will vibrate discreetly.
Irish people, I think they have such so much spirit and so much soul and passion, and I think that it's obvious that they're going to dance with their whole body, and there must have been some reason, something along the way. Nobody can give me a final answer.
Going back in time, Irish dancing was orgiastic. It was roar, and the people didn't suffer under those constraints. They danced at home. There were Irish wakes. At Irish wakes, people danced. There's a book I read about Irish wakes, and the church always condemned Irish wakes because the people would dance and dance right out the kitchen door and into the fields and do what people will do in the fields in the dead of night. And the church condemned that dancing at home. And then they decided, with the genius of the Catholic Church, to move this dancing into the parish halls where they could control it and they could make money at the same time. And keep them hands down by your sides.
I grew up in an atmosphere where in my grandparents' house in a small little country cottage, the source of entertainment was no television, radio or anything. It was dancing, singing songs and playing music, and cards, and it was wonderful. I mean, to me, it was heaven. So that was in my heart all the way through. Even getting up and doing some of these house dances, I loved it. I mean, it was wild, totally wild. There was no straight business like this. It was all very, very swing. And the footwork was just incredible. They used to beat out all the different beats.
I've accelerated the footwork. I've added an enormous amount of new moves, intricate moves, into the dance that I think are appropriate for this form of dance. I still cross my feet. I still work with my knees properly, and I have brought back moves, like just for instance rocks that I do in my solos that weren't You haven't been done in competition probably for a long, long time.
Hop, rock, two, three, hit your butt, two, three. That was all open. Your knees were wide. You could drive a truck through there. Come on. Two, three. Oops. Oh, bad, bad, bad. Do it again.
It's called a rock, and you move side to side with your knees totally straight, which I can't do, and together, and you're on rock, your tiptoes, two, and you just move from side to side. It's pretty hard. I can't get on my tiptoes like that.
Two, three. That's the girl. Do it again.
In the sense of mood, do you think that you brought sexiness into the dance, which had been there before and then somehow been eliminated?
Well, it would be nice to think so. What I have done is just uncovered the passion that's inside in me as a human, as a man. And I think what I've done with this troupe is do the same thing for the guys and the girls. Let them be themselves. You can tell when the guys do some of the big troupe numbers, and you can tell when some of the women do their numbers that it's inside in them. This is not something that, you know, we've had to teach them move by move, move by move, move this little finger here, turn here, smile. When you go behind the curtain, smile. It doesn't work that way here. This is raw stuff. It comes out raw, and it's inside. It's from way down inside. And I think there's no question that years ago, people just danced with their hearts. That's the only thing that guided them.
Dublin in 1994 saw Flatley's next big break. An audience of thousands at the Point Arena was joined by a TV audience of millions for the Eurovision Song Contest. It's Make Your Mind Up time for the juries and cabaret time for the audience.
A full-bodied orchestral dance piece composed by Bill Whelan involving traditional Irish dancers. The Celtic Choir on Una and the magical dance partnership of Gene Butler and Michael Flatley.
Ladies and gentlemen, River Dance.
How did you go to being part of that 7-minute burst in the Eurovision Song Contest?
I believe it's fate. I believe it's energy. I can take a step by step through it, but the most important step, when I was a little kid in school, I can go back to when I was 6 years old, I used to get in trouble for dreaming all the time. That carried on through high school. I'd be staring out the window, and they'd yell at me, "Will you stop staring out the window? What the hell are you dreaming about?" And I was always visualizing these things. And the things I got in trouble for dreaming those days are the things I'm doing today. I can't encourage that enough for any children or any people that want to do anything in life. If you visualize it and see it clear enough and live in color, it's going to happen. One day I was digging ditches. The next day I was on stage at the Hollywood Bowl with the Chieftains. Got 18,000 people up on their feet. A couple of days later, I got a phone call from Ireland from the producers, Moya Doherty and John McCulligan, from their company. And they wanted me to come over and to dance for a show called the Mayo 5000. They wanted me to dance for President Mary Robinson.
I know you're going to be very excited by what you see this evening. Please welcome Michael Flatley.
I don't think they knew what to expect, because I showed up in one of these kind of jackets and black pants, because I always wear these, and I had no shirt on, and I used my arms, and they freaked, and the audience freaked. got to be friends with the producers, Moya and John. They were, you know, real friendly and everything, and they started talking to me about what I'd like to do next because they were producers. And I explained to them that I had a dream that I wanted to have a big show of my own, and where I thought I could have a line of, you know, 30 or 40 or 50 dancers and a full orchestra and a big band and, you know, singers. And I just thought that there was such a market for this, particularly in America. There's such an appetite for it because I had seen it. You know, I've been touring for 10 years. It's there. It's real. So they were very excited. And I wasn't sure if I'd ever hear from them again. I went back home. A little while later, it was them on the phone. And John called me and said, listen, we just landed this Eurovision Song Contest. I don't want to, you know, hurt anyone's feelings, but I never even heard of that. I didn't know what that was. So we talked on the phone, and they wanted me to create this piece, and it was called River Dance.
Were you surprised at the reaction to those that event at that Eurovision Song Contest? Because it was quite tremendous, wasn't it?
What I didn't expect was that it was going to take the whole world by storm overnight. I didn't realize there was that much power there, but I quickly realized it.
Do you think the power came from the combination of you and the line? Because that seems to me to be, I mean, to see a terrific dancer out front is terrific. But then there's something very moving about a line. It's like a line of men marching into battle. It's a line of people doing the same exciting thing. And then you add the music and so on. And it's very dramatic, isn't it?
I believe the magic is in the combination of the two. Can't have a good army without a good leader.
For professional dancers or dancers with heart, or what, did you have anything?
Champion Irish dancers that I could mold and show them a new way to do their dance. I knew it was going to be hard again because I was, you know, a Yank, and they were trained this way, and they were all world champions. And I remember getting into the room, and as soon as I got in there and they stopped talking, I realized the worst thing you can do is say anything. So I went over and sat down in silence, put on my shoes, walked over in front of them in silence, and I did 10 seconds of stuff that no one in there could do. And I turned around and I just rose my hand and said, okay, yeah, right, how's it going? Great to see you. And then all of a sudden everybody came over and put their arms, you know, it was all friendly. You just had to get respect. That's how I started that. And they were then eager to learn this because it's what they did, only a lot harder and a lot faster. And a lot farther out. Next thing came Bill Whelan and the music. He came in with a tape of music, and it was da 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 da. That was an off time, strange time signature. I'd never danced on that time signature, and it was confusing, but it was good. It was really catchy. I listened to that, and that's all he had written. He had written the opening theme for the choir. first thing that came to my mind is you can't do 7 minutes with one piece of music. That's not going to work. Then I wanted to incorporate, according to the storyline, to bring in the girl. A typical Irish female dancer dances in certain time signatures. So I asked Jean, what does she like to dance in? And she said, well, mostly slip jig. So I said to Bill, you have to give me some 9/8 slip jig. I need about 30 seconds or so many bars of that, 48 bars of that, so that she can come out and showcase herself. Then there has to be contrast, because without contrast there's no drama. The best way to contrast the elegance of what it is she was doing was drums. The primal, get down to the bottom of it all right then. And then I asked him to create a piece for me in 2/4 time, because that's what I love to dance in. And he did, and it was great. I mean, it was deadly. The main key, I think, was the end. That was our biggest fight, to get him to come back to 6/8 time at the end. Because in order for the audience to have something to hold on to coming home, it had to be a steady beat. It had to be a steady beat. It couldn't be an off-time piece. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They needed something to grab onto, to feel like the ball got to this guy, the second guy got it, the third guy got it, the fourth guy got it, it's in. He fought me on that, but he gave in, and I think that was the best move. That was it. That was the clincher right there, man. That's when we nailed it, and it was his best music, I think, still. It's fabulous. That end piece is the one that rocks out.
With requests for this to be turned into a bigger show, taken all over the world and so on.
We opened in Dublin.
Opened in Dublin, mm-hmm. That's right. And then came to London.
Yeah.
And it just seemed to sweep everything before it, didn't it? Mm-hmm. Then there was this great rupture that you had with them. We have to talk about that. Mm-hmm. What happened there? It seems to me that you have something which is obviously very tough to pull off, but you've got a team there, you've got ideas there, the thing is working, going like a train. And then just before, was it the second season in London?
Or? That's right.
That's right. There was this bus stop, mm-hmm. and you and Riverdance parted company. Now, that's what right. happened there?
Well, I suppose it's real simple to figure out. That's contractual problems, but the three main sticking points were, A, they wanted me not to talk to the press because they didn't want the star to be bigger than the show. They were looking to make a generic show. I thought that was unfair because I'd always push Riverdance, and I always intended to do that. But I was starting to become bigger and bigger, and my name was more well-known, and I'm not sure that that was comfortable for them, although I wouldn't want to speculate as to why they put that clause in. Two, they wanted copyright. They wanted to own all my work. I thought that that was very unfair. And the most important thing is that they wanted 100% artistic control over my work and how I dance. I thought that was just out of line. The only thing I can tell you is I'm proud of myself. I walked away from 50,000 pounds a week just so I could dance the way I wanted to dance. At the time, everyone said, look, just sign the contract and dance. And it was the most tempting thing to do that. But it would have been the worst thing. It couldn't have been more wrong. It couldn't have been more wrong to do that. I would have given up everything. I would have given up everything. I wouldn't be able to sleep at night if I'd have done that. No way. It's terrible to do that to somebody. You know, I worked too friggin' hard for that. You know, there's a lot of different details involved here. But the night before to get a phone call, that wasn't fair play, I think. And
the night before the opening night?
Yeah.
Just got a phone call saying?
Yeah, their attorney called my attorney and saying, that's it. And my attorney called me, and I was in the shape of my life. I felt great. I just never doubted that we'd go through with it. And he called me and he said, it's time to put the chairs back on the tables. That's the words he used. I said, what is that supposed to mean? He said, it's over, man, that's it. They decided they're going ahead with a generic show. They're just gonna, you know, make it a generic show. And I didn't even answer him, I just put the phone down. That was it, it was over. I talked to my father that night, and he could have, you know, he could have said a million and one things. He could have been rancorous or acrimonious. He could have, I mean, he could have just flew off the handle. But I just have to say that was maybe the best phone conversation I've ever had, because we don't get to talk that often, my father and I, because he's a businessman and he's always so busy, and I am always so busy. And he said, look, Mike, you built Riverdance. Everyone in Ireland knows it. You can always build another one. You got to believe in yourself.
Were you upset by some of the press reaction?
Let them do all the talking. Let them say what they want. Let them make accusations. Let everyone else do the talking. Let me get to business, get back to work right away. I could have done two things. I had some money stashed away. I could have ran home with my tail between my legs. Or I can get up and prove that I did this. The only way that I can prove that I did the first one is to do a new one. And that's what I decided to do.
How soon did you pull out of it? When did you decide? I mean, can you remember? Was it a matter of days or weeks?
About 11 days later, I was in bed, and I just sat up straight in bed, and I remembered this idea that I had for this dance. And it turns out to be Planet Ireland in the end of my show. With Riverdance, I always believed that it could be 100% Irish show, that it didn't have to incorporate foreign elements into the show. And I had different ideas about the storyline and stuff, and so that was okay. We had to get it up and running fast, and it worked, and it was brilliant. But the second show certainly had to be another whole step down the track. So I wanted it to be a storyline. I wanted it to be something that was moving. From the time the lights go down until the time the lights come up, they have to be taken through a whole bunch of emotions. It can't just be one or two. It can't be all speed. It can't be all in your face. And it can't be all soft. Bernadette Flynn and Gillian Norris are my two partners now. Bernadette is like dancing with the air. I mean, she has energy. She has energy from down deep in her that's so real and so subtle and so calming and so good, genuinely, that when you're on stage with her, I don't have to look to see where she is. I can feel her no matter where she is on the stage. It can't be all soft. It has to be moving. It has to be touching, heartwarming.
I
It has to be enthusiastic. Gillian Norris is more fiery, but she has this deep-rooted passion in her. It has to be exhilarating. Called a meeting at Harvey Goldsmith's office in London, the promoter. There was 10 people at the meeting.
It was the first time I'd met Michael, who sat rather quietly in the corner, listening, and I think there was an assumption that perhaps he was a little naive, he wasn't sure, which was why he'd got all these rather grand people around him to tell him how it should be. And everyone put in their two bobs worth, and some good ideas developed. And at the end of it, Michael very succinctly told us the plot of Lord of the Dance, and I remember thinking at the time that was quite imaginative, that he had left, he was pretty clear in his head what he wanted.
I spent an hour explaining in detail what that show was, from the opening all the way to the pyrotechnics at the end. I waited to hear what the people, the businessmen and the financiers in the room had to say, and I just kept quiet. And then one of them said, I'll pay for it. Then the other one said, I'll pay for it. And then I said, as long as I knew they said that. And I said, no thanks, guys, I'll pay for it. I'll pay for it. But I wanted to wait until I was, you know, that was my last little, okay, I'm on the right track. So I ended up financing it myself, all of it. And it was a huge chance. And we opened in Dublin.
Was there still a bit of fallout from the Riverdance
orchestra? Yeah. Absolutely.
So did you go to Dublin deliberately?
Yeah. Yes. Not for any bad reasons, but really because it's like returning to the scene of the crime, yeah, more than anything else. I had to, it's an Irish show. It has to be born out of Ireland, and it is born out of Ireland. And I think that was maybe the most difficult challenge that I will ever face.
So what was it like when you opened Dublin? Were you very, very nervous?
I knew the press wasn't going to be on my side to begin with.
It seems to me that with Lord of the Dance, I think he tipped over into taking that very potent image and actually making it something which had its own cliches and its own kind of fed into a sort of Celtic-y, twilight-y notion of Irishness, which was actually clapped out 100 years ago.
Everything was stacked against me, but I did have the product. And I had quietly through all this, because I guess I didn't talk and everyone else was throwing all the stuff, I had sort of become the people's champion. And I came on stage and the audience erupted, and it was just the opening number. Everyone in Ireland knows, since I started Riverdance, my dream was to go to Radio City Music Hall. I didn't get to go there with Riverdance, but it was fate. I got to go there with my own show.
Welcome to Radio City Music Hall. My name's Bobby. If you have any questions on today's tour, just let me know. I'll be happy to try and answer them. I just want to start out, first of all, and give you a little bit of history.
On the 51st Street side of the building, please walk to the corner of 51st Street, make a right in the middle of the block.
The show that's currently playing here, Lord of the Dance, starring Michael Flatley, this incredible step dance show that came here from over in England, sort of a offshoot, I guess you could say, of Riverdance, but just much more spectacular.
These are the single greatest pair of shoes I've ever had, and these shoes I wore on the night of the Eurovision Song Contest. That was a very magic night for me. I've had them rebuilt 6 or 7 times. They're weighted now. They're 3 times heavier than any other shoes I wear because I work out in them so that it strengthens my muscles. So when I go on stage to dance, then it's much easier for me to be free and I can move quicker. But they've taken a serious beating. And I dare say that that the look of these shoes somehow parallels what I've been through in my life, getting to where it is that I've gotten today. Might have been rebuilt a few times. I know I got a lot of miles on me, but I'm still here.
Our story comes full circle. From a cabaret act at Eurovision in 1994, Lord of the Dance was a performance act during the 1997 Oscars in Los Angeles. Is Hollywood next for Flatley?
I would definitely like to do some film work and do some directing, and I see an enormous future in the film business, particularly for the performing arts, dancing. I know that this particular form of dance has a great future in film.
Well, behind you is the Hollywood sign on the Hollywood Hills. Do you think this is going to be a home? You've been living like a gypsy for a long time.
I suppose this is a good place to look into the future. We're out here underneath all the stars. I don't know. I've been in suitcases for 3 years now, and I don't suppose it's going to change within the next year. But I love Los Angeles, and I love being out here. Films is definitely the future.
I can go back to when I was 6 years old. I used to get in trouble for dreaming all the time. That carried on through high school. I'd be staring out the window, and they'd yell at me, "Will you stop staring out the window? What the hell are you dreaming about?" And I was always visualizing these things. And the things I got in trouble for dreaming those days are the things I'm doing today. I can't encourage that enough for any children or any people that want to do anything in life. If you visualize it and see it clear enough and live in color, it's going to happen. As long as you're willing to work for it, it is going to happen. I really believe in that. And that's what happened to me.